Right, so let me start by going through my title. So this is my title for today, the inclusion of vernacular languages in an English dominant education system. I'll be looking at the inclusion of Mauritian Creole and Bhojpuri and the impact of the politics of ethnicity in a multilingual country like Mauritius. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw extensively from reports submitted by the Ministry of Education to various international bodies like the United Nations, General Assembly, and the UNESCO. And I'm going to draw a picture of language policy in multilingual Mauritius before moving on to the key changes that took place in 2011. And then I'm going to look at how, even with the introduction of vernacular languages in the education system, English still predominates. And we will look at the reasons why this is so. I'm going to end with a question for all of us today, whether multilingualism is still a challenge and whether it can be effectively managed in contexts, post-colonial contexts like ours. So just a bit of background. Of course, I'm going to give you more information afterwards. Mauritius was colonized both by the British and the French. So we have both English and French as the colonizer's language. There is a history of both slavery and indentured immigration in Mauritius, which means that we have the descendants of the African slaves and the descendants of the Indian immigrants who live together today. So Mauritius is known to be multi-ethnic and multilingual, with English considered, and note the emphasis here on considered, as the official language. And there's a reason why I'm citing the World Factbook instead of other more scholarly work, and I'll get to that in a few minutes. There are up to 12 other languages which supplement English and then French, and this is according to the Mauritius Broadcasting Authority Act 1982. This is also a bit of a problem, and I'll get to that afterwards. Yet, unfortunately, more than 168 years after independence from the British, after British colonial rule and about 50 years after independence from the British, the coexistence of these languages is still one which is characterized by a lot of power asymmetries and a lot of social and ideological debates. So in this presentation, I'm going to explore three key factors which contribute to the minoritization of the vernacular languages of Mauritian Creole, henceforth referred to as MC, and Mauritian Bhojpuri, referred to as MB throughout the presentation in Mauritius. So I'm going to look at the ways in which language policy and planning construct English as a valuable social, cultural, and linguistic resource. Then I'm going to look at the correlation between such language policing and the differential access that exists, firstly to English and secondly to vernacular languages. And lastly, I'm going to look at the ethnic politics which further contribute to the co-association of vernacular languages, English, as the powerful language. Right? So I'm going to start by situating Mauritius, on the world map, because I keep getting asked whether it's Mauritius or Malaysia. So this part of the ocean is ours. This is our exclusive economic zone. You have land resources, we have sea resources. So for us, the sea belongs to us. For you, the land belongs to you, of course. Right? So Mauritius, in fact, consists of the archipelago of Agaliga, of the small island dependency of Rodrigues, and of course of the main island, Mauritius. I'm going to focus on Mauritius only, so not on Agaliga and not on Rodrigues, because Rodrigues and Agaliga have different histories altogether. It is just a consequence of colonial history that we've ended up together. And they've got different patterns of human settlement. So whereas in Mauritius, nearly 50% of the population today are of Indian origin, a little bit more, but nearly 50% are essentially either Hindus or Muslims. That is not the case in either Rodrigues or Agaliga, which have a predominantly Creole, that is the descendant of African slaves, population, right? So obviously the sociolinguistic situation is very different in those countries where multilingualism is still not a huge issue. Right, but what's happened also in Rodrigues and, we haven't got the feedback from Agaliga yet, is that when Mauritian Creole, because it's called Mauritian Creole, was introduced in the education system, they were not very happy. This resulted in the temporary suspension of all classes of Mauritian Creole
According to the newspapers, these classes resumed in April 2014 itself, but again, this would need verification. So I'm not going to go there at all, because Mauritian Creole has no impact at the moment on the education system there. So the introduction of Mauritian Bhojpuri to the education system had no impact whatsoever on either Agaliga or Rodrigues, for the simple reason that Agaliga and Rodrigues do not have an Indian indentured population that settled there. So we are sticking with Mauritius, and in any case, the government of Mauritius is a bit unkind and does not mention either Rodrigues or Agaliga in its official reports. So they are out of sight, out of mind, right? So multilingualism in Mauritius is due to three successive waves of colonization. The first one was by the Dutch from 1598 to 1710. In fact, the name Mauritius itself is of Dutch origins. Today, though, we don't have much Dutch left in Mauritius except for a few place names. The French colonized us for one century, I think, so 1710 to 1810. They introduced French to the island, and as a result of slavery, there was the genesis of a French-based Creole. When the British took over, the French ceded Mauritius to them on the condition that the British would maintain French culture and, by extension, French language. This is one of the only case that we know of where the French lost a war and still kept their language as the dominant language. So you can still be a winner even if you're a loser. So the British took over in 1810, and with the advent of the indentured laborers in 1834, there wasn't just the introduction of English in the linguistic landscape, but Bhojpuri and a number of Oriental languages as they are known in Mauritius, so Urdu, Tamil, Telugu, Marathi, so all of them came together. Eventually, Bhojpuri emerged as the lingua franca until it started dying out afterwards. So before I move on to the issue of language policy, I would like to provide you with an indication of the context in which the language policy making started, because it will explain the problems that we have today. The general elections that asked for the independence of Mauritius took place on 7 August 1967. So for the first time ever, the Independence Party, which was a coalition led by the Mauritian Labour Party, still one of the most dominant parties in Mauritius, won a landslide victory, and this had never happened before. Elections had been taking place since the constitutional reforms in 1948, but no Mauritian group had ever won any kind of landslide victory. So for the first time ever, elections took place and the Mauritian population voted in favor of independence. This is something that you have to bear in mind. This whole multi-ethnic and multilingual population voted, right? No one forced them. They actually went to the election booth and they voted. On 22 August 1966, the Colonial Legislative Assembly upheld the results of that election and unanimously passed a motion requesting independence for Mauritius from the United Kingdom. However, despite having voted for independence, the same population that wanted independence now started getting worried. With a Hindu-dominant population, it was feared that the Hindus would control the economy and obviously the political sphere, and that would be a disadvantage to the other ethnic groups on the island. This resulted in communal riots, which broke out in January 1967. This is a picture of one of the main roads, Defoe Street, leading away from the municipality of Port Louis, the capital of our country. The violence was so bad that a state of emergency was declared on 22 January 1967, and troops were shipped in from Singapore. You can see the armed guard in the picture to suppress the violence. It is within this context of violence that the question of language policy was first mentioned. Why would someone do that? Even today, I have no answer to that question. So on the 2nd of February 1968, Vera Somi, a Mauritian linguist who has spent the past 40 years telling us the same thing, that Mauritian Creole should be recognized in the education system, even now when it is, he's still fighting for the cause, so it hasn't really registered with him. So he wrote to the prominent daily newspaper L'Express to advocate for the adoption of Mauritian Creole as a national language, and you see that in extract A on your handout. For those who don't have, does everyone have a handout? Did you all manage to get one to share? Yes? Because if you don't have one, I'll project it on the screen. You've all got one, great. So, oops, sorry. That makes my life easier. His recommendation, as you can see, is an interesting one, that we have one common language, and we should make that common language the official language or the national language of the island. But what is particularly noteworthy is the fact that he refuses to name the mother tongue or lingua franca of the Mauritians. He just mentions that we have a mother tongue, we have a lingua franca, but he doesn't state what that is. One possible reason for that is that he was aware of the conflation between language and ethnic group. Mauritian Creole is the name of the language. Creole is the name of the ethnic group of the descendants of the slaves. So when you have a language and an ethnic group which have the same name, it becomes immensely difficult in a multi-ethnic country to reassure everyone that you have equality in mind. Right? So from what Virasomi wrote, you can see that he clearly wishes to mitigate rather than exacerbate the existing ethnic tensions that were already prevalent on the island. Unfortunately, his strategy did not work. Also, at this point in time, I would like you to note his use of the singular, mother tongue instead of mother tongues. At that point in time, we had two mother tongues, Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri. Even though the mention to Mauritian Creole is an implicit rather than an explicit one, and the Mauritian public would have known that he was supporting Creole because he's always been a Creole activist, the exclusion of, I'm sorry, okay. No, okay. The exclusion of Mauritian Bhojpuri is still one which is felt. So Mauritian Bhojpuri associated with the descendants of the indentured Indian immigrants, Mauritian Creole associated with the descendants of the African enslaved. So from the very outset, in a climate where there was already communal riots on the island, there was the insidious promotion of an ideology of exclusion towards Mauritian Bhojpuri, and of course that added fuel to the fire of ethnic discord. Now, 1 month later, on the 12th of March, 1968, Mauritius celebrated its Independence Day. Now, you can just imagine how wonderful that would have been for the then Prime Minister to be given his independence while the rest of his population was fighting for power, for language issues, for predominance. So the new government existed in a very precarious situation. The possibility that there would be another riot was an omnipresent one. The possibility that peace would not be re-established was actually a very strong one, to the extent that most international observers predicted that Mauritius would die out very quickly. Either the country would die out and we would ask to be reclaimed by the United Kingdom, or we would kill each other and hence die out. So, in post-independence Mauritius, the Prime Minister had no other option. He chose to deliberately eschew the adoption of any measure, so he deliberately did not go into language policing because he did not want to be seen as being partial to any particular ethnic group. In fact, the Prime Minister was so scared of communal riots that he clamped down on all forms of political dissent, and the next elections took place in 1976. So roughly 10 years after the first election, and our constitution dictates that elections should take place every 5 years. We've managed to do that for the past couple of decades, though. So as a result, because of the fear that existed at that point in time, Mauritius chose to maintain all the legal and institutional provisions made by the British colonial powers. In a sense, there was the tacit maintenance of the Act of Capitulation of 1810, which said, okay, the French are leaving, but they're leaving their language behind. But when the British took over, for the sake of practicality, they had to change the language of administration, the judiciary, and eventually of education to English. So this is what was maintained, English and French, right? There were a few changes that took place during the British era. Namely, there was a tentative move towards compulsory education in the mid-1800s by Governor Higginson. It was never fully implemented, of course, because even though the education was meant to be compulsory, Higginson recommended that the education system should be financed by having a small amount of money deducted from the salaries of the indentured laborers, which clearly they were not comfortable with. But during Higginson's rule, that's when the decision was taken to provide education in the vernacular languages. He was particularly inclined towards Tamil, but his successors, Governor Fair and Governor Anderson, and eventually Governor Donald Mackenzie Kennedy, introduced all the languages that were spoken by the indentured laborers. So, of course, these languages were taught not very well, not on a large scale, but they had already been introduced, and this is what Mauritius kept. Notice one thing here, that Mauritian Creole and Bhojpuri, despite being at that point in time the most widely spoken languages on the island, they were not acknowledged either by the British colonial powers, and eventually, because post-colonial Mauritius upheld those decisions, these two languages, the existence of these two languages, were not acknowledged, right? So what was the reason for that? Even though Governor Higginson attempted to democratize access to education, well, the way to hell is often paved with good intentions. So because he was not very familiar with Bhojpuri, Higginson came to Mauritius after working in India, but he worked in Agra, so he was not very much exposed to Bhojpuri. So when he heard Bhojpuri, he thought he was hearing Hindi, so he labeled Bhojpuri as Khari Boli Hindi. And this is what was included in his education system, and eventually this is what the government of Mauritius adopted, right? On the other hand, the French colonial masters, when they realized that there was another colonial power there, the French never left. They stayed, even though the British took over. So they were in a very difficult position. So what would they do? So they decided to associate themselves with the former enslaved. Former enemies, now friends. So they told the former slaves that, okay, the Creole patois is French. So under Higginson, when provision was being made for education, Creole went under the label of French, Bhojpuri went under the label of Hindi. So this resulted in the exclusion from all official censuses during the colonial era of Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri. The one good thing that post-independence Mauritius did was to include Mauritian Bhojpuri and Mauritian Creole in the census in 1972, right? So even then, even after including those two languages in the census, the government chose to leave the education system untouched. So the diarchy of English and French was maintained. Slots were provided in the timetable for Hindi, Urdu, Tamil, Telugu, and Marathi. And with the independence of India in 1947, there were a few teachers who traveled from India to Mauritius and helped in the teaching of these languages. So this is what Hubert has to say about post-independence Mauritius. So Mauritius became independent on 12 March 1968 and was then said to be the paradigm of the small, isolated, poor, dependent country, only emerging from the colonial era to fall immediately into neocolonialism, the third world's third world. So that was our situation then, right? Is it our situation now? Pretty much. We're still the third world's third world. So what's the impact of neocolonialism on language policy in Mauritius? So language policy has remained covert, and I'm using here the Schiffmannian distinction between overt and covert language policies. Overt language policies are defined as explicit, formalized, codified systems of rules and regulations that govern the use of languages. Covert ones are the opposite. There's no explicit formulation for a language policy, but you infer regarding what you should do by reading multiple administrative documents, right? So this is what Mauritius has been doing so far. So the MBC Act says there are 12 plus 2, so 12 Oriental languages, 2 official languages, for want of a better term. We believe that. So today, language policy in Mauritius has remained covert. It has not been formally institutionalized. English is considered as the de facto official language, and that has neither been confirmed nor undermined by successive governments. The fear of a riot is a strong one. There's only one mention to the issue of official language in the Constitution of Mauritius. That's Article 49, which states that the official language of the assembly shall be English, but any member can address the chair in French. Read here between the lines and assume that the official language of schools, the official language anywhere, is English, but you may use French. Even though I should point out, when this was challenged in court, the court overruled this, saying that you only state that the official language is for the assembly is English, but you haven't stated that it is so for the judiciary and for other systems. So each time this decision has been challenged in court, the court has said that Mauritius has no official language and you can't apply it. So when the government applies an English-only education system in Mauritius, it is in fact in violation of the constitution. So the rest of the constitution, in fact, shows you a case of a strategic omission. Because we don't want you to fight, we are not going to mention anything that will lead you to fight. Okay? So this leads us to the two following questions. How does a multilingual country, which has a de facto covert language policy, continue to maintain its neocolonial commitment to English? And secondly, what is the impact of this neocolonial language policy upon Mauritian Bhojpuri and Mauritian Creole? So I'm going to answer the first question, obviously, first. So I want you to see extract B on your handout. It is taken from a longer report that the Ministry of Education submitted in 2008 to the UNESCO. And just for fun, I would like you to pay close attention to the punctuation marks utilized. Yeah? Did you notice that the word official is bracketed by single quotation marks? This same strategy is adopted in a few other reports submitted by the Ministry of Education to multiple international bodies. So this is an indication of the formal stand adopted by our government. You have an official language, we have an official language. Whether both official languages are equal, clearly no. Right? So the single quotation marks are accompanied by additional verbiage. The 2008 report, like all other UNESCO reports, required the ministry to provide information regarding factors that could exclude students from the mainstream education system, and the response of our ministry is lovely. See extract C on your handout. So in the extract, again, mention is made to the mother tongue, not mother tongues. So your guess is as good as mine. It could be either Mauritian Bhojpuri or Mauritian Creole. However, I'm going to assume that given the fact that Mauritian Creole performed better in the 2000 census, the implication here is that mother tongue refers to Mauritian Creole. So in this extract, the Ministry of Education is effectively opposing languages that are taught at school, namely English and French, and those that are not. So English emerges as being doubly privileged in that report, first as the official language, then as the language taught at school. It is in direct opposition to the mother tongue, and at this point in time, with 12% of the population still claiming to use Mauritian Bhojpuri as their everyday language, Mauritian Bhojpuri should have been also considered in that report. But because it wasn't taught, it was again omitted. But the ministry believes, and this is important, that there is no language barrier that disadvantages students in Mauritius. Right? Doesn't matter what language they speak at home. It doesn't matter what language they speak at, or languages they speak at school. We all speak the same languages. We all understand each other all the time. That is the official stand of the ministry. Now, over the years, the Mauritian government has made a very tentative, a shy attempt to move from covert to more overt forms of language policy making. For instance, following the last general election, we got a new governmental web page, so govmu.org. And on that web page, the government clearly says that English is the official language of Mauritius, no single inverted commas. Here it is, English is the official language at the bottom. Right? However, even when our government tries to carry out overt forms of language policy making, it still makes mistakes. So the sister webpage, that of the Ministry of Tourism and External Communications, provides a summary of facts and figures for tourists. And on extract D on your handout, you will notice that the Ministry of Tourism says that we have two official languages, English and French. And the webpage even very helpfully points out that French is more popular than English. This is so confusing that Richard's 2012 even claims that French is the official language of the island, and I don't blame her. So a similar degree of confusion exists at the level of the number of languages which exist in Mauritius. The MBC Act states that there are 14 of them. I've never managed to find out what those 14 languages are. I can't reach 14. I've been counting for a while. My students have been counting as well. It hasn't helped. The ethnologue says that there are 7 languages in Mauritius, and it lists English as the national language. An entry in the Encyclopedia of Bilingualism and Bilingual Education goes further. It says we have 20 languages. Conveniently, it doesn't provide a list of those languages, though. The Ministry of Tourism and External Communications, and here I thought, hallelujah, also said that there are 7 languages. Unfortunately, the list provided by the ministry is not the same as that provided by the ethnologue. So there's only one point of consensus. Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri are two of the languages most commonly spoken on the island, and English is important. French is important as well. However, how can a country that does not even know how many individual languages exist on its shores ever manage to create an overt language policy that is fair to all of them? You want to include vernacular languages or all languages? Great. You have to first of all tell me what those languages are. And we are, at the moment, incapable of doing that. This is so confusing. So I'm going back to the CIA fact book, that the fact book cites the following census figure, which went unreported in the report generated by Statistics Mauritius, which says that 0.1% of the population belong to a category labeled as unspecified. Now, there is no language called unspecified in Mauritius. So it means that they either refused to reveal what language they spoke, or the language that they spoke was not represented in the census, or they did not manage to give a good enough answer, right? Now, in Mauritius, we do not answer our census reports ourselves. Someone comes to our door and very helpfully fills it out for us, or in my case, never comes to my door and fills it out himself. Job done. So we will never know what 0.1% having an unspecified language means, but what we know is that, logically, the government should make provision for that as well. So we have many languages. We don't know what those languages are, but we do know that we've signed a number of conventions that tell us that we should make provision for them. Right. So this is particularly worrying because Mauritius officially, for the UNESCO, etc., it adopts a very, very politically correct stance. So one of the earliest formal documents that explicitly states the commitment of Mauritius to maintaining all its languages is in a report that was submitted to the Secretary General of the United Nations in 1996. So this was the reaction of Mauritius to the Declaration on the Rights of Persons Belonging to National or Ethnic, Religious, and Linguistic Minorities. So this is what our government had to say. Right? And as at 30 August 1996, at the time of the publication of the report, Mauritius was special. It was one of only, out of only 10 other countries that bothered to send its views to the United Nations. So we might be late with lots of things, but we do send our views. So what were the views of Mauritius? The government of Mauritius stated that the rights of persons belonging to national or ethnic, religious, and linguistic minorities were guaranteed. Note, guaranteed, in a country where they don't know whether they have linguistic minorities in the first place. Technically, though, your rights are guaranteed if you come. Right? Technically. So on the 20th August 1970, Mauritius had already signed the UN Convention Against Discrimination in Education. In 1986, Mauritius also signed the African Union's Convention on Cultural Charter for Africa, which means that officially we have committed ourselves to protecting, supporting, and sustaining all languages that exist on the island. This means that for the past 45 years, the country has been in breach of multiple conventions that protect the basic human and linguistic rights of the population. And this is a fact that's been picked up, of course, by the 2011 and 2012 human rights reports. So these reports were published after the 2010 general elections, elections which were meant to change our fate, of course, as all elections are. And in its list of what it considers to be human rights violations, the report includes the complete disregard to Mauritian Creole. It does not mention Bhojpuri, but I don't blame it. Our government does not often mention it either. The disregard to Mauritian Creole was to such an extent that the polling material for the election in some places was not available in other languages. So do you know how people in Mauritius vote? If you don't know how to read and write, you check the symbol and then you put a cross next to the symbol. Clearly. So if you have someone like my grandmother, for instance, who is not very, who obviously is not literate in English, but is literate in other languages, so what she does is she goes to the polling station, and she looks for the symbol, and then she votes. The problem arises when she gets confused with symbols, clearly, because there are symbols which resemble each other. So if you have more people who are not literate in English, well, there's no guarantee that the prime minister you have is one that they actually voted for, because they didn't vote for a prime minister, they voted for a symbol. Could have been a horse, could have been anything, but that's what they voted for, the horse, right? So from the early 2000s to now, in every yearly report that has been published by the Committee on the Rights of the Child, which works under the aegis of the Human Rights Section of the United Nations, so it has kept drawing the world's attention to the fact that Mauritius is, in a sense, paying lip service to all recommendations which say that you need to establish a multilingual education system which is fair to your vernacular languages. Each time Mauritius writes a report back to them which says, we will, or we have already done that. And each time we have another report which says, you haven't done it. But, okay, the Center for Children's, for the Committee on the Rights of the Child celebrated its 25th anniversary this year. For the past 20 years, it has been recommending every year without fail, right? 20 years. That shows a huge amount of commitment. That Mauritius should consider the use of a mother tongue language. In the same vein, it has also told us, and it continues to tell us, that any subjects that have proven to be fundamental to the overall development of the child is either not offered in Mauritius, or it's not given the same level of evaluation. So it doesn't just include the mother tongue, but it also includes music, art, anything that's meant to enhance your personality. So these reports over the past 20 years, they keep saying that whatever decisions we have taken or not taken, they are to the disadvantage of children, and they consist of a form of discrimination. We see those reports, they are available, they are online, the government has not suppressed them, and anyone can read them. We read them, and we forget about them. So, it would seem, though, that after 20 years, the government was, okay, to an extent, sensitive to the criticism that it faced. So it sought to remedy this situation in 2001 through a stronger form of overt language planning. So it opted for the standardization of Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri, and it finally introduced them as optional subjects in 2012. So this is the timeline. So an Académie Créole Mauricien was set up in 2010. At the same time, the Mahatma Gandhi Institute in Mauritius was contacted to create materials in Bhojpuri. By 2011, everything was ready. In 2012, both subjects were offered in Standard 1, At that point, they were offered in Standard 1 only. Today, they are offered in Standard 2 and Standard 3. Both Creole and Bhojpuri technically are meant to count as optional subjects when the grading process takes place at the end of primary school education and students get their certificate of primary education. So as from 2017, so 5 years later, these two subjects should be examined. So what do we think? Has there been any change? Are vernacular languages now considered to be at par with English and French? At first glance, it would seem so. We are very good students. International bodies are happy with us. So for the first time ever in 2014, the Committee on the Rights of the Child wrote back and said, this initiative has been very much welcomed by most of the civil society. So we've ticked our boxes. We are in line, finally, with recommendations. In actual fact, this does not seem to be the case. Mauritian Bhojpuri and Mauritian Creole are optional. English is compulsory. You can't opt out. In fact, according to the report that Mauritius submitted to the UNESCO in 2011, so knowing that it is going to introduce Mauritian Bhojpuri and Mauritian Creole and that it is standardizing them, this is the report that it submitted, where no official provision had been made regarding the inclusion of these two subjects in the weekly timetable for primary school students. In fact, what the government did was it reproduced a table that it had created in 2001 and it sent it there. This is a table that lists the weekly time allocated to multiple subjects. I know it's a bit small, but you can clearly see that English and French are given 500 weekly hours at standard one level. And if you go down towards optional subjects, you can see that Oriental languages are provided with 200 hours, religious education with 50, right? I do hope that you haven't seen Mauritian Creole or Bhojpuri. They're not here, right? So Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri were technically going to be implemented in the education system, but there was still hope that they would not be. So the timetable was not changed. It still hasn't been changed, by the way. I'm waiting for a new report, right? So we can only speculate what the government had in mind. So possibly it would provide them between 50 to 200 hours, or it would decrease the hours to the other optional subjects and reallocate them to these, but we have no official guarantee from the ministry. In 2015, so this year, the Mauritian government had to submit the Education for All report to the International Bureau of Education, and it very happily acknowledges that it has effectively included vernacular languages in the education system. Yet, although it repeatedly says that the timetable has been updated to include extracurricular activities, we call these the enhancement program, it does not make any update to the WTA table. In fact, in this whole document that's sent to the International Bureau of Education, Mauritian Creole and Bhojpuri were mentioned only twice. So it would seem that we have made omission, we have turned omission into an art. In 1968, the Constitution conveniently omitted to provide an official language to the country. From 2011 to 2015, reports from the Ministry of Education have omitted to provide crucial information regarding vernacular language teaching and learning. So what we can see is a perpetuation of a practice that results in the minoritization of Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri. I don't know what's going wrong, but it keeps acting up. So it's indicative of the potential failure in a sense of overt language planning. But what we have to understand is, what is the reason behind the decisions taken by the Mauritian government? Most of us create an ivory tower for ourselves and we live in them throughout our life, saying that you need vernacular education, English is the killer language, etc. Languages do not have the potential to kill by themselves, people do. Would you rather have a language policy which results in the minoritization of a language, or would you rather have a killer population? That is the question that our government faces. Ramanathan says that around the post-colonial worlds, when you see inconsistencies in language policy, you do have to go back to colonial times. So Mauritius does claim that it was successfully decolonized, but its successful decolonization is marred by fears that there will still be communal riots, and there were again communal riots in 1999. So one of the reasons behind the ambivalent attitude of the government of Mauritius towards Mauritian Creole and Bhojpuri is due to the ethnic tension that originated during colonial times. In fact, the 1943 Moody report, which was ordered by the then colonial government, recommended the provision of education in only English. So this is what extract E on your handout says. Because according to Moody, education in any vernacular language was going to result in civil war, right? If you look at extract E, you will see that he uses the words that Mauritius will never stand as a nation and as a language, right? So let's contextualize a little bit so you can understand what the poor British went through when they reached Mauritius. So when the British colonial regime was established, there was a Babylonian situation. The plantocracy were French-speaking and they controlled the economy. So if the British wanted money, and Mauritius was economically one of the strongest colonies of its time, which is why we were the only colony where compulsory education was even thought of. The British administration was English-speaking. The former slaves were by then Creole-speaking. There were a few South Indian skilled workers brought by the French. They were Tamil-speaking. The indentured laborers spoke Bhojpuri, Tamil, Telugu, Marathi, etc. The only people who spoke English were just the British administrators, and there were a handful of them compared to about 3,000, 4,000 of other people. So there's no guarantee that anyone understood each other at that point in time. They tried, of course. So the only solution that the British could see clearly was to try to build a nation through the use of English. What else were they going to do? Build the nation through the use of French? Well, the British and the French, unfortunately, at that point in time in Mauritius, they were not very good friends. To the extent that the French plantocracy would regularly protest against the British. There were riots in 1937, but not communal ones. It was just the French being a bit unhappy with the British. So the irony is that the current national anthem of Mauritius is in English, so it seems that we have learned something, and it seems to be very inadvertently, I think, referencing the Moody report. So where the Moody report said that we will never stand as a nation and as a people, our national anthem in English replies, so there we go, we are standing as one nation and one people. A bit of a disabled nation though, right? So the Moody report was a reaction after 100 years of unsuccessful attempts by the British to establish vernacular education. They wanted to, they tried, it never worked. What was the reason for the failure? Those former descendants of the slaves, they were very, very annoyed that the British colonial regime appeared to favor the indentured laborers, and that they, the first inhabitants of the island, well, after the Dutch and the French, their language was not being recognized. In fact, Bessac wrote that the free slaves feared that with the introduction of any Indian vernacular language, their Creole was going to disappear, so they absolutely disliked even the mention of the introduction of vernacular languages. So was it true that the British were favoring the indentured laborers? Yes, because they had nothing to gain from the free slaves. Obviously, the indentured laborers were brought to Mauritius because the slaves were free, so there was no one to work the land. The British regime had more to gain by a population that would work the land for it, and so it decided to work for its rights. So the first governor, of course, to try and create a comprehensive language policy is Higginson. So in 1954, he lobbied the colonial office for compulsory education in English and Tamil. We don't know why he favored Tamil, because the Tamils were not brought during the British colonial regime. Might have been a quirk of his, no one really knows. The colonial office, for some reason, acceded to his request and turned his recommendation into law. But the colonial office was more ambivalent about the language issue and said that, you know, you should ask the population. So Higginson said, okay, I should ask the population, let me not ask them, and introduce education in as many languages as I can. Now, the former slaves and the French plantocracy protested, resulting in Higginson pacifying them by telling them, don't worry, I'm going to give grants to Catholic schools targeted at the Creoles. So on the one hand, you have indentured laborers who were predominantly Hindus and secondly Muslims. On the other hand, you have Creole speakers who were already at that point Christians, Catholics, Protestants, but mainly Christians. So when you say, I'm going to introduce vernacular languages, but I'm going to make you happy by giving money to the teaching of your religion. These grants were approved by the colonial office. These grants are still provided today. The only change we've made is that we also give grants to religious bodies just to ensure that nobody fights. So for the first time ever, when legislation was taking place, Indian languages were, pitted against the provision of education for Creoles. Religion became an issue. And this was a situation that was perpetuated by Higginson's successor, Governor Phair. This is an ethnic divide that has never, ever been fully resolved. It explains the use of the singular each time by Dev Virasomi and then by the Ministry of Education. Because how can they find themselves in a difficult situation? Do they mention both of them? They play it safe. They mention just the one. In fact, during the standardization process for Mauritian Creole and Bhojpuri, to avoid the potential of ethnic groups thinking that, you know, they have been disadvantaged, the Minister of Education asked each group to maintain the purity of their language, so no switching. And this is very difficult when two languages have existed together for so many years. So the extract on your handout shows the instructions given by the Minister of Education regarding the standardization of Bhojpuri. Make sure that there is no Creole word. In fact, Erickson even says that in 1972, when the government decided to introduce Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri on the census, the two questions that were asked were, what's the language which is currently or usually spoken at home? And what was the mother tongue or the language of your forefathers? Unfortunately, these are the instructions given by our government. Column N, languages, mother tongue, very important question. It is intended to supplement column E, ethnic group. So in other words, it wasn't asking the people what was the language of your forefathers. It was asking them what was the ethnic group of your forefathers. In fact, in Mauritius, religious groups can tell their people what they should answer on the census. So this is the National Telugu Federation telling all Telugus, so please answer Telugu, Telugu, Telugu in all three columns. Thank you very much. Right? So whenever we have census figures, take them with a pinch of salt. They are the result of crazy policy making. Right? This is worrying given that even in 1972, Mauritian Bhojpuri had already become the lingua franca. Telugu had already died out. Tamil, Telugu, Marathi died out very early on and Bhojpuri took over. So one can, if there's tension amongst the Indo-Mauritian population, you can speculate, because you don't live in Mauritius, about the tension that could exist between Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri-speaking population. So let me end by saying that obviously language policy does not exist in a socio-political-cultural vacuum in Mauritius. In our case, ethnicity has a significant role to play. So you can get all goody-two-shoes on us and tell us include vernacular languages in the education system. But let's ask ourselves the question, what other option does the government have? A government is answerable to the UNESCO, to all sorts of bodies, etc. But at the end of the day, the people in the government live in Mauritius. What kind of life are they going to have if any decision that they take results in civil war? In a country where a whole government collapsed in 1983 because the national anthem was translated into Mauritian Creole, where the Minister of Education threatened to resign because his ancestral language appeared lower down on banknotes. So his language was not in second position, it was in third position. In 1995, a government lost the election, the outgoing government lost the election on the Oriental language issue. Can you genuinely listen to the goody two-shoes and say that you should introduce Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri and give them equal importance to English? Mauritius is multilingual, yes, but we are also living in a difficult post-colonial context. The communal riots in 1999 showed that we have learned no lessons between 1968 and now. Bhojpuri and Creole speakers appear to be their own worst enemies. There's too much ethnic tension between them. I will simply end with a question. Yes, we should provide languages in the mother tongue because research has shown that this is what's best for our student. Is this what's best for Mauritius? There's just one question. At what cost would you want education in the vernacular languages? Is it fair to have civil war in small post-colonial states because the good thing to do would be to have education in vernacular languages? Thank you. I'm happy to answer any question that you might have. Thank you. There's a question there, though. A Creole uses the Roman script, but even the assumption that Bhojpuri has to use Devanagari, that is very wrong, because Bhojpuri eventually was spoken as a lingua franca by Tamils, Telugus, and Marathis, etc. So when Bhojpuri is in Devanagari, but when it was standardized in Devanagari...
That is the Hindi khadi boli now.
Yes, yeah. But then it becomes the language of Hindus. Those people who were using it as lingua franca, now they can't use it, because you've written it in a script that they don't understand. The Perso-Arabic script of Urdu, the other scripts for Tamil and Telugu, they could have been used to write Bhojpuri. They weren't. So we've just taken a language that was not ethnicized within the Indo-Mauritian category, and we've made it a Hindu language when it was not a Hindu language.
Another two questions.
Yes.
Leave the language, official language, but majority of the Mauritius speak which language?
And another, Mauritian Creole, 90% of the population speak Mauritian.
And another thing that, like India, in election, generally people use the vernacular languages. They are using English in the parliament, but election that Hindi, yeah. Bengalian. So like in Mauritius also?
As in...
In election propaganda and all this.
Yeah, I mean, during the meetings, they use, the public meetings, they use Mauritian Creole. Some of the promotional material will be in Creole, but on the day of the election, good luck to you finding out information that you want.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Questions. Yes.
See, one is to try and ask, you said 90% speak Creole.
Yes.
Yeah, and obviously then you're saying the Bhojpuri is 10%.
At the moment it's at 5%.
Or 5, but does that mean that your 90% are monolingual Creole speakers?
There is no guarantee. In fact, our...
because that's the issue. Whether if you have a class then, will you have a class where it's a homogeneous Creole population, or will it always be 90? Is there majority,
that
minority?
I cannot
terms?
Answer, because how can I answer how many speakers of Bhojpuri you will eventually have in a class? In
no, you don't have that data yet.
No, it's
not you.
I don't think we do know in a classroom what percentage of speakers are actually Mauritian Creole speaking and what percentage of speakers have even a passive knowledge of Bhojpuri. In fact, even with the census, you don't know whether the 5% of people who say they speak Bhojpuri exist.
Will all Bhojpuri speakers then anyway be speakers of at least know and understand Creole?
Probably
yes.
Yeah.
So maybe you should be thinking of Creole and English as the two languages, but...
It is very probable. But when you select Mauritian Creole over Mauritian Bhojpuri, the message you're giving to the Indo-Mauritians is that you are
not... There's a religious issue.
Yeah, you're not important to us, so they will fight.
I have only a suggestion, which is, as an individual, not obviously policy decisions, that maybe you will, as you said, to avoid civil war, your country will have to live with English as its medium of instruction.
Yes,
and
it does seem
probably
like it.
Try and see whether Mauritian Creole and Mauritian Bhojpuri, as you've called it, can be brought in as but somebody was talking about in the morning as a scaffold.
It's already
as
done.
Enabling.
Our teachers are very clever people. Whatever policy you adopt, they are still going to do what they think is best
in
their classroom.
Then it would be interesting to look at the data that comes out with that kind of use and what's happening to English proficiency.
Okay. I think yes.
Yeah, as a suggestion, looking at to document rather than apologizing and, you know, pretending it doesn't exist, who's using which other language for which purposes and how is it helping English? Mm. Because my other question was, what are English proficiency levels in your country? How good, how bad? Let's take CEFR. Let's deliberately take an available...
Statistics form 5 levels, so O levels, 50% of students fail.
Yeah, so English levels are not fantastic because you said your teachers are not fantastic. Therefore, it stands to reason that you need to use the local languages.
Yes.
That research might be...
But you can't officially say that. Because
don't say it officially. Get the documentation first. Get the documentation as to which teachers are using which languages for what purposes.
Okay.
And
we will
push
try.
For that rather than... Because see, you've... This,
yes.
is a, this was what? One drastic hit at policy and its problems accepted. But where does that take you as a researcher?
Okay.
So this is just a suggestion to you.
Thank you.
In terms of what you can
suggestion
do.
Suggestion accepted. Yeah. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you.
Brendan Rigby, University of Melbourne.
Thank you for
tracing the historical trajectories of language policy and planning. It was really interesting for me, knowing nothing about Mauritius. And now I feel like I know a lot about it. Just 2 questions. The first one really quickly, and I'm sorry if you already said this. Are there any indigenous languages on Mauritius?
No, because Mauritius was not populated.
It
colonization.
Unpopulated.
Yeah.
Okay,
populated us, yes.
And then second, it's more of a question for you to think about. And just building off the last question.
You know, no, there's somebody else at the back.
To what extent are people's choices in language use every day, as it's happening in the communities, in classrooms, to what extent are they examples of everyday language policy and language planning happening amongst people? So we're not talking about language policy and planning
top down,
from top down. We're talking about
up.
Bottom up, people's own choices, how much of that?
No, the people are rarely given any choice. When Creole was standardized, if you read the document, I know you won't understand much of it, but I am a native Creole speaker and I don't understand much of it. Because what has happened is that those who decided to standardize the language, they took lots of French words and they just wrote them in a Creole manner. And pretending that these are Creole words, so changing a few pronunciation features. Let me give you an example. There's a lot of z sound in Mauritius, so jeudi, zedi, jeudi is Thursday. So they'll take a word that has the z sound and they'll give it the z sound, and bingo, it's now a Creole. So bottom up, even those who are meant to be taking decisions for Creole speakers and they're meant to be helping them, in a sense they're not helping them. My worry is that with Mauritian Creole being introduced as an optional subject, if it's too difficult for students to connect in, now they won't just fail English, they won't just fail other subjects, they will fail in their native language as well. Then what?
Thanks.
Thank you very much. My name is Aaron Ngosi from South Africa. I just want to ask a very stupid question. Are you saying before French colonization in Mauritius, there was nothing?
There was nothing.
Okay. Now, don't you think, I know that somewhere 2011, the pass rate in matric was about 31%. The whole country in Mauritius. Don't you think the issue of the language is disturbing in terms of the learning outcomes in that province?
Can you repeat your question? I think I missed part of it.
I'm saying the learning outcomes in matric.
Yes.
High schools.
Yes.
It was 31% at some stage. I know in 2011 it was about 31% output in matric. We call it matric.
So CPE, mean? Yes. So 31% out.
Yes.
That's correct.
Yes. Don't you think that is the effect or the impact of the language? That is there.
I think that the 31% failure has been attributed to the fact that there's no Mauritian Creole in the education system. My belief is, though, that there is no study on recruitment practices in Mauritian governmental schools. Postcolonial contexts are also known for high rates of corruption. There is no guarantee that the best people are in the best place and that the quality of teaching is what it should be. You can introduce Mauritian Creole, but the version that's been introduced is one I'm uncomfortable with. There is no guarantee that students will succeed if the quality of your education, and I'm using quality loosely, I mean the training of your teachers, what they do in classrooms is good. Let me give you an example. The SACMEC report, which is prepared for the African Union regularly, states that we have a district in Mauritius, Black River, that scores below the average for the whole of Africa. That school has the best teachers. It's got the best library. It's got the best facilities compared to schools in the rest of the country. Yet the rate of failure is the highest in the whole of Africa because students don't go to school. And there is no motivation from at the parental level for sending them to school. So quality of teachers, parental involvement in the education system, students' own aspirations as well, because there is a tendency in Mauritius and elsewhere to think if you are poor, then it's the job of the government to provide you with the means to get out of poverty. You know, the mountain should come to Muhammad, but that is not the case. If you are already marginalized, the government can only make provisions. You have to take those provisions, and that is not the case in Mauritius. Many people are still waiting for the government to materialize and take them by the hand and go to school. So the 31% failure could be attributed to Mauritian Creole. There's so many factors, though, including human factors as well. Those who are used to being helped will always want to be helped and not be educated, because what's the use of getting an education if you are going to be helped anyway? Thank you.